Becca, the naturopath from New Zealand. Thank you for coming back and checking out the channel. We always appreciate it. I've got lots of questions to go through. Every week I get questions. You can imagine, we've got lots of subscribers now and people send through all kinds of questions. So here's a question. Why do many medical practitioners think that candida infections are complete bogus? I wrote a bit about this in the book Candida Crusher. In fact, things are changing. Slowly things are changing. Interesting, when I had a look at the source of information, Wikipedia, which is extremely medically minded kind of a website, people like me who take an interest in candida are basically called shamans and quacks and fringe dwellers, or pseudo-scientific cult members, I'm being called. So, wow, I didn't know that I was a David Koresh fan all of a sudden. I don't belong to any cults or I'm not involved in pseudoscience. I've got a bachelor degree. I didn't get a master's or a PhD, but in fact, my teachers have been my patients for more than 3 decades. When you're sitting in my chair and you treat people repeatedly, time and time again, for not just years, but decades, you start to see a pattern developing where, particularly I saw this in the 90s, 80s and 90s, probably more so than today, but I saw many medical practitioners would poke their head in the sand and be ignorant to a candida problem for a person. The only candida issues that were taken seriously were generally females with vaginal yeast infections. But men, people like me in my 20s when I had a candida problem, I was treated like a fruitcake, basically, told to see a psychiatrist. Now, some patients I've spoken to, even recently, still get that kind of a stupid deal when they go to a medical practitioner. But not all medical doctors are cut from the same cloth, okay? You need to understand that. There are many incredible amount of medical doctors out there now who've taken a big interest in candida yeast infections. In fact, as I mentioned, things are changing slowly. Even on the Wikipedia page, which is extremely pro-pharmaceutical medicine and pro-surgery, and anything else beyond that is quackery, even on the Wikipedia candidiasis page and on the candida albicans page, you can read there, particularly on the albicans page, you'll be able to read that practitioners need to take yeast infections more seriously and not just look at bacterial infections. So things are changing. So the whole idea about systemic candidiasis being a pile of crap is actually not true. We know that people can get infected systemically. And many, again, medical practitioners believe that when someone like me says that it's, it's bogus, it's nonsense, it's not based on scientific fact. Well, in fact, I'm sorry, it is based on scientific fact. In fact, in 1969, if you're a doctor watching this, dust off your old Lancet medical journal, the prestigious Lancet. There was an article published in a 1969 Lancet where a man called Mr. Krauss, in fact, had proved to the medical community way back, 50 years ago, that in fact, if you swallow candida, if you're perfectly healthy, and you've been proven to be healthy through every kind of test performed on you and they can't find candida, when you swallow several capsules containing viable live albicans, literally within a few hours, you can get extremely sick doing that. And not only that, within several hours, a blood draw confirms candida albicans is actually in the bloodstream. So we know that people can get yeast infections systemically without having to, acquired AIDS, for example, because we used to think that AIDS was a disease that, of course, rendered immunity so low that many people would get sick and die from basic infections like candida. But we also know now that many people get candida who don't have serious immunocompromised, ability. Even healthy people can get candida. What also more and more doctors are recognizing is that antibiotics are not the right thing to give to people routinely because they create a yeast problem. As I've mentioned many times on this channel, half of my time has been spent over decades repairing the damage that was obviously, occurred after antibiotics, particularly yeast problems in the gut. And not only that, but also SIBO problems and many other problems that people face with bacterial overgrowth, rendering all almost more certainly susceptible also to parasite infections like blastocystis, which are rampant, which many medical practitioners, in fact, now believe is part of the normal microbiome, a parasite like blasto. So you're either going to go to a doctor with blinkers on, who still follows the old line that diseases are bacterial, that if a person has a cough or sniffle, they need a drug immediately or they'll die because of that symptom will kill them. You know, you've got the old school doc, but you've got the new school doc now. You've got younger graduates coming out. The older dinosaurs are dying off, thank goodness, and the new breed is coming through. Now, new doctors are learning a lot more about microbiome and even probiotics and how beneficial bacteria are. Because, of course, I'm 60 now, so the doctors I've dealt with all my years when I was younger were all T-Rexes and Brontosauruses and all these old dinosaurs. We don't need these old dinosaurs anymore. We need new dinosaurs, right? New people, new technology, new understanding based on microbiome. So this whole idea that the problem's all in your head now is actually slowly fading away because thank goodness, all the work I've based my practice around is finally being scientifically validated after decades and decades of being called a charlatan, a quack, a pseudoscientific moron, all these things. Finally, people are being recognized, in fact, as leaders in medical, not, you know, the pseudoscientists. So the future of medicine will be far more regarding microbiome and particularly understanding the role that Candida plays in the gut. Because, you know, as experts point out, 19% of women have this yeast normally occurring in their private area by default. So, you know, and a lot of people, not everybody, but a lot of people have Candida albicans in their gut kept under control. But it's the overgrowth that we're concerned about, the imbalance. So it's not about getting in there and curing Candida and killing this and all this sort of nonsense that I hate to see all over YouTube. It's about getting the balance back. The doctor of the future will give no medicine but interest his or her patients, okay, in true ways of living, working according to the laws of nature. And if we do use medicines, we use natural medicines, not pharmaceutical, highly synthesized drugs that make people sick and kill them. That should be the pseudoscientific cult. Those are the people that should be the fringe dwellers who give poisons to people, peddle poisons, and then point the finger at us. So in years to come, all these drugs will be gone. There'll be no more toxic drugs used on humans. Well into the future when people have really got this understanding of toxicity, medical toxicity, in their heads. But I think what will change is when the profits are coming more from microbiome treatment and novel probiotics made. That's when the profits start coming up, you'll find a lot of the poisons hopefully will start going down. So why do many doctors miss the diagnosis still? And that's because they follow the old school line, okay? The conventional old medical professor's line that all diseases are not caused by Candida, it's impossible for that to occur, and we still have this fallacious belief. So in time that will change. But for now, remember, you've got the old dinosaurs and the new ones. So if you've got a Candida problem, go to a new dinosaur, go to a new doctor. Don't go to the old school because you'll probably end up getting a referral to a psychiatrist, unfortunately. Thanks for tuning in. Don't forget to read my book, Candida Crusher, and particularly the first few chapters where I talk a lot about why practitioners miss the diagnosis. And I go much more deeper into why medical practitioners think that this diagnosis is a sham. Thanks for tuning in, as always.